So the science behind what makes InstructLab possible is something called the LAB method. LAB stands for large-scale alignment for chatbots, but actually the scientists who invented it just really like dogs. The elements of the LAB method is having a taxonomy-based skill and knowledge tree from which data used to fine-tune the model is derived. Now, normally in AI today, a lot of folks who are trying to fine-tune models, they take the blender approach. So they just take whatever data they have available, kind of throw it in a blender, mix it all up, and then check to see, did it come out nice? With a taxonomy-based approach, what we're doing is we're actually building out a tree of the kind of like to make sure that the knowledge that we're throwing into the model and the skills we're throwing into the model are more balanced. So it's not just, oh, well, I happen to find some stuff and whatever stuff I happen to find ends up in the model. It's more rigorous in that we're making sure that we're covering sort of a broad range of knowledge. Or even if you wanted to build a model using the lab technique and you wanted to specialize in one area, you can kind of identify where you might have gaps just based on where you don't have enough knowledge in the tree. So taking a taxonomy-based approach to fine-tune a model, necessarily by having that tree representation of what you're putting in, helps you identify where you may have gaps and might also help you identify where your knowledge and skills might be a little too heavy. So it helps you have that balance that is really nice to have for getting good quality results. Another approach to the LAB method is something that we call synthetic data generation. Now, this is what makes InstructLab a really cool, approachable way of contributing to models. So normally, when you're training a large language model, you need a vast amount of information to move the model because large language models are large. So you kind of need a large amount of data to make them change their mind on anything. With synthetic data generation, you can take something like, say, 8 examples, like my 8-year-old daughter created 8 examples of jokes that were then run into a synthetic data generation process. And what we did is we took something we call a teacher model. We use an open source teacher model, and that will take those 8 examples my daughter wrote and sort of extrapolate more and more and more jokes. So you could extrapolate that to 1,000 jokes. Now, 8 jokes might not be enough to sway an LLM, but 1,000 is. So that's one of the cool things about this technique is as a contributor to the model, you don't have to come up with 1,000 examples. You can just come up with 8 or 6 or 10, and it'll take care of the rest for you. Once we have a synthetic data set, we can take what's called a critic model, who will basically look at all the synthetic data that was generated and then see, is that correct? And it'll let us know if the synthetic data generation actually worked well. So for example, it might take the 8 jokes that my daughter wrote that are definitely funny and come up with 1,000 more jokes that really aren't funny or don't make sense. So the critic model can kind of go through step by step with each set of jokes or poetry or whatever else was generated and try to assess the quality of it. Based on that review, we can decide, yeah, the synthetic data is not great. Maybe we go back and improve our jokes to make it better. Or maybe what we're trying to do, like maybe this isn't good at generating jokes, but it is. You know, maybe we need to look at something different. Maybe we need to format it different. There's a lot of different ways. But using synthetic data validation with a critic model, you have somewhat of an idea of whether or not it's worth investing the time into then fully training the model. When I first heard about synthetic data generation, I was a little nervous. I'm like, how can AI possibly pull this out of the ether or pull this out of these 8 joke examples? But it's not doing that. It's actually using those joke examples as a guide to then kind of consult the archives and see what it already knows and see how that matches a pattern. So that's sort of part of the mystery of what's going on that really unlocked how LLMs work for me and how this technique works.